HQ presents Finding Lucy by Diana Finley, read by Rachael Beresford. Chapter 1 1984 Alison. It was after seeing the grave that I finally decided to take a child. There was nothing special about it. The grave, that is. Not one of those ghastly, over-sentimentalised affairs sprouting angels' wings or teddy bears. Quite plain. A simple stone and a concise message. In memory of our dearly loved little girl, Lucy Sarah Brown, aged 2 years. Born 20th of September 1982. Died 16th of October 1984. Safe in the hands of Jesus. Somehow, imagining little Lucy's life and her demise touched me deeply, coming as it did just a month after Mother's death. How desperately tragic. What might have killed a child so young? A car accident? Meningitis? A hole in the heart? How her parents must have suffered. How they must have grieved for their dearly loved little girl. Still be grieving, in fact. She'd been gone only 2 months after all. So very sad. As I thought about it, I almost wished I could share my plans with them, with Lucy's original parents. Let them know that, in a sense, their Lucy was going to be brought back to life. I was going to bring Lucy back to life. Perhaps they would be comforted by that thought. Of course, telling them would never be possible, and anyway, she would cease to be their Lucy. She would become my Lucy. Lucy would be my secret. She would be my daughter, my secret daughter. How perfect! Lucy Brown, a fine, tasteful name, yet normal. Not one that stood out too vividly, just like the sad little grave. It wasn't as though I had planned the whole thing beforehand. Thought it through, not at that stage. The idea grew out of a medley of thoughts that had been swirling in my mind, indistinct, like miscellaneous letter-shaped noodles stirred into soup, sometimes emerging for a moment to make meaningful combinations on the surface, then breaking up and disappearing into the depths of the pot. Stumbling upon the grave that day drew the letters together, began to make order and sense of them. I had decided. It was a bright, crisp December day. Long shadows streaked the wet grass. Early afternoon, but already the sun was starting its descent towards the rooftops. As often before, I had been wandering through one of the city's urban cemeteries. Not that I was attracted to such places for any macabre reasons. No, it was the quiet I yearned for, the peace, and perhaps the sense of the past. This was a particularly agreeable cemetery, serene, well-maintained and cared for, with mature trees and shrubs creating a screen from the surrounding suburban streets, emphasising the separateness of the graveyard. At first I had been drawn to the grave simply by the fresh, bright flowers arranged in neat vases, which contrasted with the faded, bedraggled blooms nearby. But standing there in front of the grave, my attention soon moved on from the flowers. I was mesmerised by the name, Brown. It is natural to notice one's own surname. I stood and gazed at the neat letters, the scrolled stonework marking the boundary of the pitifully small grave and containing shiny gravel of various colours pink, brown, yellow and green. On the headstone, carved stone hands curved beneath the words, "Safe in the hands of Jesus," as though gently lifting them, or perhaps Lucy herself, upwards, heavenwards. All the while, as my eyes absorbed these details, my heart was beating unevenly and with great excitement. A plan started to take shape in my mind. It was so simple. Lucy Brown would become my child. Indeed, my invention. Just as, years ago, Mother had created me as Alison Brown. I could hardly wait to get home and begin to put my ideas onto paper. Chapter 2. Once back in my own house on the other side of Nottingham, I made a cup of tea, sat down at my desk and started to write a list. I love to make lists. So reassuring. Firstly, the birth certificate. Having that in my possession would make it all seem real. This first item on the list occupied me for quite some time. I worried about the application process, though. Would proof of identity be required? As it turned out, discovering the details of Lucy Brown's parents' names and dates of birth was extraordinarily simple. All I had to do was to write to the General Register office, giving Lucy's first name, surname, and date of birth, and requesting a copy of her birth certificate. An address was required. I provided my own, of course. I sent the modest payment as indicated, and a week or so later, the precious document was in my hands. I studied it with a trembling thrill. It was almost as though I held Lucy herself, as if she was reborn. Her mother's name was given as Audrey Brown, and her father's as Russell Brown. That would need some adjustment in time, of course. I would be her mother, Alison Brown. But then people often used a different first name to the original one. This was just the beginning. Much needed to be done, but that did not deter me, not at all. Indeed, anticipating the tasks ahead filled me with great pleasure and excitement. I had already decided to stop working for a time. Mother's death had left me feeling deeply unsettled. It had always been just the two of us. Apart from my brief and unhappy sojourn at university, I could scarcely remember spending a night apart from her. Or rather, the very few occasions when we had been apart stood out in my memory as rarities. Exceptional. And a little frightening. Now, suddenly, I found myself completely alone. During those initial weeks of bereavement, I found it impossible to enjoy anything of ordinary domestic life. For example, mealtimes. I ate almost nothing at all. Sitting alone at the table where, all my life, Mother and I had sat together, sharing the small events and anecdotes of the day, felt almost as though I were in the grave rather than Mother. I found little pleasure in my own company. Sleep was even more difficult. I tried to postpone the moment of plunging myself into darkness by reading for as long as possible, often reading the same passage over and over again, until exhaustion forced me to switch off the light. As if by signal, this act heralded a succession of morbid, disturbing, and often terrifying thoughts which would not be still. Sometimes I was obliged to get up and make myself a cup of chamomile tea and sit with it in the armchair in the soft light of the kitchen until a fitful sleep eventually overcame me. Dr. Munro, who had known me since I was an infant, suggested a mild sleeping pill might help.
Just during these sad and difficult early weeks, my dear.
I accepted his prescription, but never swallowed a single one of his pills. No, it was not my preferred way. It was important to remain in control of my consciousness. At the office, my mind would not focus properly. Every task seemed difficult, yet nothing seemed to matter to me as before. I felt the need for a complete change, a time for peace and reflection, a time to reconsider my life and my future. Perhaps it was something to do with having turned 40 last year. Not that I believed in phenomena such as midlife crises, but it was surely reasonable to regard 40 as a chance to embark on new endeavours. So, back in November, not long after Mother's will was read, I had handed in the obligatory 3 months' notice at Chambers.
"So, what are you going to do, Alison?"
asked Mrs. Anderson, the administrative manager, promoted well above her capabilities, I always believed.
"Have you found another job to go to?"
"Not exactly. I feel it's time to reevaluate, to think about the next period of my life and work out exactly what I want to do with it."
Mrs. Anderson sniffed.
"Reevaluate? Sounds a bit of a luxury to me. Re-evaluation isn't something most of us can afford. Still, I suppose it's unsettling to lose your mum when you've always spent so much time together. Is it that?"
"Certainly losing Mother has been a blow." I paused for a moment. Mrs. Anderson sighed and glanced at her watch.
"Yes," I said hastily. "You're right, very unsettling."
Despite this unsatisfactory exchange, I was touched to note the genuine regret expressed by most of my colleagues at my leaving, both the legal team and the administrative staff.
"'Spect you'll miss us here in the office, won't you, Alison? What are you going to do with yourself all the time?"
Julie was the newest office recruit. Her long nails clacked away on her typewriter. "I'm sure I'll find plenty to occupy my time, Julie. Oh yeah, going to museums and libraries and that." She winked at Debbie and they giggled, without revealing the source of their amusement. "Certainly," I mused, "I would not miss the banality of office conversation." It was clear that Mrs. Anderson was at least sensitive enough to register the strength of my determination, because at no time did she try to dissuade me from my decision. She had never been generous with praise, so it was a particular pleasure to see myself described with words such as efficient, invaluable, intelligent, loyal, and highly valued in the brief note about my departure circulated to the staff. It would have been perfectly proper for Mrs. Anderson to have written a personal note or card to me at home, and perhaps to have wished me well, but this was not her way. At the end of my last day at Chambers, a select gathering had been arranged in the main office by way of a leaving do. Cups of my favourite Earl Grey tea and a tray of tasteful and dainty iced cakes were handed around by the juniors. I was seen off with a gift token, a bunch of flowers, and a jovial peck on the cheek by Sir Julian, delivered amid the usual waft of winey fumes. He had not long returned from his usual lunchtime expedition.
"A new year, a new life. Hey, my dear, jolly good for you."
I tried to smile benignly. He could never have imagined how true those words were. Chapter 3. I had wanted a child of my own for as many years as I could remember. I might even admit to having felt a desperate longing for a child. I frequently recall Mother's words to me during the last days of her life.
"Don't live alone, Alison," she had said. "It's not good for you, dear. I do so wish for you to have a child to love and to love you. I won't be a grandmother, of course. It's too late for that. But if only I could know that you will have the joy of being a mother.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.